Blog Talk Radio.
Goddess Fleurbrun is going to be joining us tonight, our sister, our friend, our star from another mother. She's going to be joining us tonight, and we're going to be discussing Archons and Soul Contractz. And I'm going to just read a little brief because I'm going to get into the song that we're going to play. Some of tonight's questions that are going to be discussed are what is a soul contractz? How can you break it? How can you take back your spiritual sovereignty over your own being? What are archons and how are they affecting your life? Do you feel like your energy is being pulled by parasitic energies? And do you want to know how to get rid of these blood-sucking vampires? So we're going to be discussing this and how they feed off of fear, our fears, and those type of things. So the song that I was choosing to bring her on was The Backstabbers, because are we really getting stabbed in the back or are we stabbing ourselves in the back? I mean, we feel like, you know, people are doing stuff to us, but is it really them or is it someone else? So we're going to play the song before we bring on Miss Fleurbrun to the set. So just a minute. Sorry about that, Dad. Betty Wop is everywhere. Okay, hold on. Just
okay.
All right. Might be your neighbor. We don't know who it could be. We don't know who it could be stabbing us in the back. But thank God we have Goddess Fleurbrun to let us know who really is stabbing us in the back. So without further ado, let's bring on the goddess.
Peace, queen. Peace.
That song gave me flashbacks. I love it.
Oh.
It is so reminiscent, too, of the time.
I know.
Killing in your face while I stabbing you in the back.
Right.
We don't know if they life forms, aliens, parasites. We don't know what they are. Might be ourselves. Right. Yeah.
Like, who are you? You know.
Word.
So, hon, let's get into this tonight because, I mean, the people want to know. They're going crazy sharing our links about this subject. Go into what exactly are the Archons?
Well, the Archons, from a general perspective, are the architects of the Matrix. They are the ones who are allotting the hologram or making the construct of our illusion world that we're residing in now. This is the Matrix that we're in right now. And all that we see, all that occurs, all the trends, they're really kind of set forth by archonic forces. Archons are parasites who feed off of fear, fornication, and, fighting. And they tend to construct this matrix based on to kind of overwhelm us with aspects that would create, fear, fornication, lots of sex, lots of fighting, and, lots of, other things. That is what they feed off of. They are a parasitic entity, parasitic species that thrives and lives off of our negative, our lower behaviors, our lower, more primal behaviors. They feed off of that negative energy, and they construct the matrix. They make everything so that is consistently being perpetuated. If you ever watch, some of us have little people, but if you ever watch Monsters, Inc., anybody? That kind of gives you a good idea of the Monsters. Their main purpose was to go create fear for the little kids in their bedroom, and that whole, the fear, as soon as that little child screamed or was fearful, it would feed their whole world with energy. So they would have lights in their world, and all their electronics would work based on the fear that they created from these little children that they were working to, create in another world. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of what the Archons are. They're vampires, basically, feeding off of all of our negative primal energies.
Wow. Now, Sis, I wanted to ask you, I don't know if you had a chance to view. Now, for our listeners that don't know, there's this guy, this Caucasian guy.
Oh, yeah.
On YouTube called This Crazy German, and he gives a lot of truth in his videos, but recently he did a couple of back-to-back videos. Did you get a chance to see them yet?
I think I saw maybe the last, maybe two. I didn't see that. If he made any more, I haven't gotten a chance to see. Maybe two, maybe last week I saw.
Okay, because he was talking about the feeding, how they feed and the mushrooms from his planet, how the fungus grows off of our fears, how they create these extra dimensions and feed off of the fears of the people here.
Yeah. We've kind of come to the conclusion that he's probably an Archon. That's probably what he is. He calls himself a tall white alien. I don't think that. I think he's an Archon. I think that's what the Archons are, those entities. They're parasites, vampires.
And I thought about you today when I saw the video because I'm like, well, I thought this is basically what what Fluerbrun said is Archon is the ones that feed off of fears, and he made it perfectly clear that this is how him and his race feed. They feed off of our fears down here.
Absolutely. And most of the Illuminati, what they do in their rituals with children and with anybody abduct and create you know, torture, part of what they do is put so much fear into the soul that they've captured at the time of death. That entity is so based in fear that some sort of adrenaline flows through their bloodstream, and at that mm-hmm. point of the heightened state of fear, they murder that entity and they drink the blood, which we know liquid is frequency, you know, blood. So all that fear is that blood, and that's what they do in their rituals. That's well known.
Wow. So this is why a lot of them have, they're like kind of not as sensitive to pain as, you know.
Absolutely. They're numb. Mm-hmm. They're numb. And that's why we have a society in a non-Indigenous world. When I say non-Indigenous, I'm talking about a society based with people that are highly, that are non-melanated, mostly have a very low melanin content. Those people are very, they just don't have as much sensitivity. People of color, the more melanin you have, the more hypersensitive you are to your environment and to anything, electromagnetic shifts, electricity, we're hypersensitive. The less melanin you have, the least amount of sensitivity you have. You're kind of numb to things. And if you look at our society now, we have roller coasters. We make Halloween a big thing with fear. You see people doing things like jumping out of planes and stuff like that, climbing mountains with nearly die. And you say to yourself, that doesn't seem quite normal. But, yes, look at who constructed our mm-hmm. environment. And then mm-hmm. you look at them physiologically, and you overstand that these are the same entities that have been considered funguses by the Africans on first time they saw them. And funguses, what they do is they feed. It's interesting that the white tall says he comes from a planet of mushrooms, but a lot of the Europeans have some of the characteristics of a fungus or a parasite or you know something that feeds off of things and kind of drains it. Mm-hmm. You know, not very symbiotic either.
Right.
Without its knowledge, without its permission. Yeah.
Now, is this related to why Caucasian people, now, because I just recently heard this, I think my mother was telling me this, about how they, when they die, they turn black quick or something?
Oh, they turn a darker color?
Yeah, it's like they, not disintegrate faster, but they don't stay as preserved.
Well, we don't know. Yeah, a lot of the, not all. Mm-hmm. We got a lot of entities. We don't know that ever. You know, I don't want to offend, and this is why I say it's just purely from what I know to be,
mm-hmm.
and that could change upon learning something new. From what I know, that a lot of Europeans were genetically modified, and they were created in a way that they were not meant to be here very long, not many generations. It was kind of like an experiment, and that when they pass away, they don't really have anything to go back into the earth. It's almost like they petrify. It's probably what your mom is talking about. They look petrified. They don't disintegrate naturally like an earth being. Yeah.
Yeah, because I was, because I started reading about it, and they were even saying in like some of the forums, they were like, yeah, we have to bury. That's why we have our funerals, and we have to hurry up and bury our dead because they might, you know, they start turning a color very quickly, like,
mm-hmm.
so.
Yeah, well, they don't have melanin, and a lot of you see all the atrophy and everything. You start to see the, when I go into when I get petrified afterwards, I mean, their skin is pretty see-through, so that could be that, too. It could just be a biological thing because they don't have the melanin shielding. You know, that's kind of like our coating. So you can't see what's going on in the inside, but on the inside of them, their skin is kind of see-through, and
mm-hmm.
probably you see the blood turning from red to black. So it could be that as well, you know, seeing that.
Okay.
And remember, I had this conversation the other day. We were talking about eye color, and I said there's no eye color except for brown and black.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the discrepancy, but if anyone's taken basic physics or biology, you know that if you appear to have blue eyes, it's not that you have blue eyes. That is a reflection of your veins. They don't have any shielding or any coating over the eye. So all you're seeing is a clear, see-through lens that is reflecting the blue veins behind it. It's not an eye color.
Wow. And you see how they glamorize this?
people
that have.
But it's not healthy because that's what, yeah, makes you susceptible to having eye damage from the sun. The reason why we have natural, why people who have very fair eyes have to wear sunglasses is they're mimicking those with dark brown eyes who are indigenous to the planet.
And to think that you have celebrities purposely going to get their eye colors changed, you know?
And it's, you know, but that's that projection, you know. Projection, a lot of self-hatred that's been projected into, you know, the melanin dominant community is that, you know, it's actually reversed psychology. They're perpetuating that you're supposed to be less, you're less, but really your genealogy is more domineering and it's more superior in just in being able to survive on a planet that you reside on. So why would they continuously perpetuate things that are recessive that will allow you to perish a little sooner? You know, melanin allows you to live. I know women who are 60 years old who look like they're in their 20s, especially if they're healthy. We don't age.
Right.
And melanin is a superpower.
Wow. And it's sad, though, when I read about melanin and I try to read about it in the white communities and the way they discredit it, like, we're tripping, you know?
They discredit it, but they study it. That's the main study in every private organization. They have tons of research on melanin alone. They've been researching this behind closed doors. They have millions and trillions of dollars going into the research of melanin. And that's why on the black market, melanin is higher in cost and value than gold. Yeah. That will tell you something. Mm-hmm. So that's not true. Dr. Prookman, I will shout her out, Dr. Prookman, Jewel Prookman, goes deep into that. She was a doctor, GYN. She's a phenomenal holistic practitioner along with she talks a lot about melanin and her research and her dealings in the medical community with entities researching us unbeknownst to us and how many ailments that we have are really spiritual, you know, depreciations are, you know, trauma that we're experiencing and we create in our body. She's wonderful. Dr. Jewel Prookman, I got to shout her out.
Wow. Yeah, she is phenomenal. And you can, for our listeners, you can check her out, too, on YouTube. And she has books that she's written. And she's very, very well-versed on melanin. So
she's a bomb.com. Yeah.
Yes, she is.
But back to the Archons. Well, we just noticed the difference between people who appear with more melanin and not. And the Archons are parasitic. And every parasite that you will see, including cancer, is white. So you have to be mindful. Yes, cancer's a fungus, and you can get rid of it with baking soda. I mean, we'll get into that.
Okay.
Cancer's a fungus. It's a fungus, and if you keep eating acidy foods, black people, and starch, and, you know, a sugar, that's what is created in our bodies, is a fungus. You just keep depreciating your cells, so... You know, stay away from things like that. Stay raw, more raw-based, and then you'll be more spiritual. And parasites don't like to feed off of people who are alkaline in their spirit, alkaline in their bodies. They can't feed off of us. And Archons do not like healthy vessels. I will say that.
Okay.
And we can get into drugs, which is a tool for Archons to get access to us easily. More easily.
What do the Archons look like? Are they in like a physical form? Like, can they manifest in a physical state, or could they just be a demon?
I can't say. I've never had a physical attribute of an Archon, just a general synopsis of their characteristics and what they do, but when that white German came, he gave me a physical look to that. He gave that, and you sent that. It was a gem. It was like it was wonderful because we needed to see a face. Even though Archons could look very different, it may not even be physical, but it gave us a face to go along with what that entity may look like to us in this plane. And we have to be mindful of them. Archons work on you. A lot of times what you'll notice, Archons are in your ear and your consciousness all the time. You ever see the cartoons with the devil on the shoulder and the angel on the other?
Yes.
Okay. Well, the archon is the one in the ear telling you to do things, to be paranoid. Oh, he's cheating. Oh, my God. Oh, she's looking at you. That's the archon. And a lot of times we don't know that backdrop is not our own consciousness because we're not even conscious. So we're allowing these things to hijack our own subconscious, and we think it's our thoughts, and it's really them. That's how they work, and they work in your dream state too. They give you nightmares. They work on your fears. So if you have a fear of anything, the archons know it, and they will generate more of it. People, places, and things.
Wow. So they're very telepathic.
Highly, highly. That's how they're able to do everything they do.
Wow. See,
they know more of our minds than we do.
I should say that.
Wow. And so this is why it's so important to really guard our thoughts and what we're thinking.
Mm-hmm. And you have to know yourself. Know thyself is more important because you can't differentiate something else's voice in your head or somebody else's thought if you're not even solidified with your own thoughts or who you really are. And part of doing that is living in your truth, living in your what you like, what you enjoy, so that when a voice like that comes in your head, you'll be like, that's not me. I don't know who that is, but that's not me. Better get out of my head. Yeah.
Hey, can you talk about that, Fleurbrun? Can you talk about how we have these thoughts? We think that the thoughts are ours, but they're really not our thoughts.
We got a couple things going on, and I'll touch on the three main ones that I know to be probably the most prevalent right now. We have the archonic forces that are the constructors, the landscapers, or actually the engineers of our matrix. They're the ones who are generating fear. They have access to you. You're created in the matrix. So they pretty much are plugged in. If you ever watched the movie The Matrix, you see how you're plugged into that pod and you're kind of sleeping and they're generating, you see energy going and they're generating your dreams. Those are the archons. That's how they get to us. They talk to us via they use our subconscious against us, and they utilize it to create havoc or sadness or depression or fear in you consistently every day, all day. That's why most of our society is all depressed and fearful, or people recreate in their matrix havoc based on what they're getting in their subconscious by these entities. And they do exist. It is a fact. I know it to be. And over the years, I've seen so much happen with them within my own life. Then we have something a little different. We have nanotechnology, which they're working on us. And, we have chips. Some people, especially military people, are chipped. And with those chips, a lot of times, do you guys remember that military guy, the black guy who went shooting, he went and shot a couple people at the base. This was not too long ago, maybe 2 years ago.
Yeah, it's an alien.
And
they happened here when
we lived there. Remember what they were saying. He, before this happened, he said he had things in his head. He was hearing voices. He was hearing, like, not just voices, like crazy voices. He was hearing, like, commands. Like, he was hearing,
commands,
like,
yes.
Yes, commands in his head right before this happened. And he said he believed the government had chipped him. Now, I think this was a little bit further back. The young lady who drove to Washington, she had a child in the back, black girl, who was shot in Washington in front of the Capitol. She also had said that she was hearing voices. She was also being gang-stalked by some entities. We don't know who they were. Could have been government officials. We don't know who she was at this point. And she was hearing voices, commands, in her head. They're chipping people. And you are hearing the transmissions in your head, and along with the nano technology that's coming out down on us every day through chemtrails that's going in your skin, causing Magellan's, like your skin pops up because of the fibers, the metal fibers going into your skin. That also is a form of nanotechnology that controls your physiological makeup. So we got them putting technology in, you know, chipping people. And remember, all military people are chipped. I don't know anyone who's not been chipped. That is part of the protocol now. That is what it is. They're chipped. Just like the dogs who, you know, just say if your dog, oh, do you want to get a tracker on your dog? They've been doing that to people for many years now. They're chipping all the military men. They say for tracking reasons, we know it's for control. And you have those entities that are being utilized for what, however they want to, and controlled by government agencies, I don't know, subgroups, you know, cults, we don't know. We don't know. Mm-hmm. That's another form of mind control and getting in your mind and talking to you. And the third one, which some people, like the Christians, you know, really big Christian base, and I think some of the other religious bases talk about demonic possession, which a lot of times, you know, like I said, I don't personally ever like to use the word demon because a lot of times these entities are just, I can't really judge them. They're coming from another realm, so we don't know what they are. We don't know really what their agenda is. They just cause havoc when they're in us. You don't know. They could have been good guys on the other side, and they're just pissed off and want to go back. I don't know, or they want to control you. I don't judge it. I don't know.
Right.
But those entities can temporarily attach to your force, your auric field around you, especially if you are doing drugs and heavy alcohol. That is why it is called wine and spirits. It allows you to have a vortex open to deities and spiritual incarnates, whatever, demons, whatever. They can attach to you, and they can sometimes go inside of you and control you for, you know, short periods of time, sometimes longer. And, you know, sometimes I say they're walk-ins. You know, walk-ins can be a little bit of that. And with those entities inside of you, if you're low vibrational, if you have low vibrational type of behavior, like you're just, you know, you're just belligerent.
Right.
Just walking around belligerent, talking about people, miserable. That's low vibrational. And you are susceptible to being a perfect host for a parasitic, demonic entity to latch on to you and not only infect you, but infect your family, because that entity attaching to one will cause hell in your household for everybody else.
Can you go into, like, what are some of the characteristics of the demonic possession? That you might have an archon around you or something.
Okay. Well, possession, usually, okay, there's certain, from an outside perspective, I'll give you both from you knowing if you have one and then you being someone who's perceiving somebody who you feel or may find suspect of being possessed or have some sort of attachment. Now, one of the things I noticed, and maybe because I broke the code, one of the things I noticed is that whenever somebody has a demon, and I'm going to use that word because a lot of people know that, and I want them to identify what I'm talking about.
Okay.
Whenever someone is in the realm of being in a close contact with somebody who has something on them, the first thing you will smell is sulfur. It is it's so weird because I come from an island family, so that's something we know. We kind of were taught that in some of, you know, you'll hear some of the older people talk about it, like the smell of sulfur, as an indication that there's a devil in the house. You don't hear the whole Grinch Christian say it. There's a devil, there's a demon in the house. That's not sulfur. Sulfur is an indication. If that entity is talking to you and their breath or their skin has a repelling scent of sulfur, and if you don't know what that is, it's just like, it's like eggs, a very slight hint of old eggs, very slight. And that's why they created all these mouthwashes and stuff. I mean, people think because of not only that we're eating dead flesh all the time, but they did that so you would not be able to notice signs of these entities.
Oh,
it's masking
God.
It.
I deal with a lot of these people on a daily
basis. Yeah, this
one. I'm about to see some of the kids too. I'm thinking right now.
No.
And it kind of like your nose starts to burn, right?
Longer term possession, you'll see yellowing of the eyes. Now, that's longer. That's when an entity has been on a person and latched on, usually for a long period of time. When I say usually, it's more than 6 months or over a year. You won't see that at the beginning. So I say it because I want everyone to know that It could be something else, but these are all aspects of possession. That doesn't mean that someone's possessed because they have yellowing around their eyes. No, it could be a health reason. But I'm letting you know everything along with the series of things that go along with it. Also, the flipping bipolar behavior. Hey, how you doing? Fuck you. I mean, shit like that. Like that. Excuse my language. You know, in the same breath, they're God and the devil. Bipolarism is not, that is an unnatural behavior. It could be sociologically based, yes, and it could be clinically, it could be clinically based as well, yes. But anyone who is doing things going from A to Z in 2 seconds, like from going to being a normal person and you not recognizing them, and the behavior is not reminiscent of the person that you know, that is also a sign of possession. Also, these entities have a tendency to have issues with their bones and their backs and stuff because they're not used to being in human form. So a lot of times people who have possession have issues with walking, knee problems, back problems. And again, and I don't want people to think that everybody with a back problem and knee problem is possessed. No. Take that along with the other signs and put that together. That is also a sign. Animals not liking them. Animals are hypersensitive, especially dogs and cats. If a person has, every time they walk outside, dogs bark at them, and, you know, dogs are sensitive to everybody. I'm not saying every dog barking at someone is a sign of a demon, but if that person has dogs, every different kind of dog, a neighbor's friendly dog barking at them, and the neighbor's mean dog barking at them, a neighbor who has a dog who doesn't even lift his head barking at him, and animals being very sensitive to that person and running away from them, that is a strong sign of demonic possession. Because animals know, they can read the energy. Black flies, we talked about this before, black flies, the magnetic field around someone who's demonic, for some reason, and this is in the Bible, I believe, there's a book. Maybe not the Bible. I'm sorry. Let me retract that. I think it's the... someone will probably know this. Not the Talmud, Kabbalah. Kabbalah book. I believe so. Don't quote me on this. I believe this is the book. They stayed about the flies coming when the demons came too. They brought swarms of black flies with them. Black flies coming around the house, they're very hypersensitive to the magnetic shift. If you have a demon in, once they come in, they almost create like a black hole. So these flies are attracted to that magnetic shift. So you'll see flies around people like that all the time. And it doesn't always mean demons. Sometimes when the angels, sometimes I've heard this from one person, and this was a while back, and I had to think about it. One person who's very angelic, they had flies that used to just come in a room and just bother them. Not a lot, but like once or twice. But it means your magnetic field isn't, there's something going on with your magnetic field that's not normal. That's a sign of something going on. So those are a couple of the signs when you're looking at somebody from the outside. Now if you're possessed, you're going to have nightmares. Nightmares are an indication because when you go into the ether, you get an idea that others are with you, that are not your friends, they're not your family, and they're usually demonic. And, a lot of times we can have entities that are parasitic or vampiric going into the ether and feeding off of us. But they're attached to us on a regular basis in our energy fields in the day. So they come in your dreams and you see them like, I don't know, they're giving me nightmares. That's usually an indication of a possibility of you being possessed. Also being very drained all the time for no reason. I'm not talking about your iron being low or low B12 or nothing like that. We got to kind of omit that. Had too much sex, none of that. No, we're not talking about that. We're talking about, like, you're drained and there's no possible reason. You're a pretty healthy person, and then out of the blue, you're just drained for no reason. That's also a sign that something's attached to you and on you. Also hearing voices. That's another thing. When you hear little audio voices, that could be an attachment to you that you're hearing. You know, you guys are so close. You're actually able to pick up the frequency of that entity attached to you. Graying of the hair, instantaneous. Waking up, you didn't have a gray hair. I had that happen. waking up and having a gray hair. That's also from something being in your realm that's caused, you know, almost like a fear, a subconscious fear, and it's showing up, but you don't know it consciously. It just shows up in your body reacting.
Okay.
I think that's it. It's probably a couple other things, but that's kind of it.
Okay, because I'm just like, so in my mind, I'm thinking that these archons our projections of, like,
it could be
the part of us that is low vibrational. I don't know if I'm saying it right.
Well, we could be creating it ourselves, because remember, we're living in a hologram and you are co-creating your environment. So if you're thinking low, you will create something reminiscent of a demon around you or other people or in your dream state. It could be that too. It's so many different things it could be. But the archons are so tricky. That's what I'm saying. We don't even know to the depth of these entities. We know they're parasitic. We know that they control everything in this matrix. We can't really say what they do and what they don't do, because they do everything almost.
Okay.
And like in the movie The Matrix, the Smiths reproduce themselves. Kind of think of the archons as the Smiths. Every time Neo was in the Matrix, a Smith could be a little girl, and then he'd switch and morph into the old man on the corner. Kind of think of the archons as like that, the Smith.
Okay. So Fleurbrun, what if you are encountering an archon, but they're coming to you, and maybe they might come to you as like an innocent little child. How do you discern? Or someone that is just so angelic, you're like, oh my God, they couldn't possibly be. You know, how do you use discernment to figure out who this person is?
I think that's the hardest one, because you really can't. We live in a mad, mad world. You really can't. I mean, all I can say is if you are considered to be somebody who is making waves in a good way, chances are you're going to be met really strongly by the archons and other parasites who tend to take you down or to feed off of you. So I always say, if you're somebody who's really, really high or really, really low, chances are you're going to be violated by the archons more so than others. So the highest you are and the lowest you are, they're going to attack you much more strongly.
Okay.
The lowest people, and I don't want to say low, but, you know, people who are challenged with their frequency, you know, they have addictions, they've been traumatized. That's why MK Ultra works so well, is because the children from young are traumatized with all kinds of sexual deviations and abuses and physical, you know, abuse and mental abuse. These entities make wonderful hosts for demonic possession. And a lot of times that's why they do it, along with bloodlines. You know, different blood groups are more susceptible. If you are European and you're O negative, you are bred specifically to be susceptible to having possession. That's why you were bred. You're susceptible to mind control more so than everybody else, and you're susceptible to being inserted with something. O negative European.
O negative. So is that a bloodline that's common amongst the Europeans?
Some. No, not necessarily all. The Ashkenazi Jews, majority of them are O negative. Yeah. And look what they're doing in Israel to the to the Sephardic Jews, who are brown people. But they're, you know, you see what I'm saying? Their consciousness is a little more challenged, and they were created, and this is my opinion. No, this is not, I would say this is what I know to be. Remember, we were all hybrids. So I don't say this like I am better than anyone, because we're all hybrids, and we were all created for purposes. Some of us were created just to be slaves. I'm being honest. So I don't say this to say to disrespect anyone who's European, because everybody's here is being used in some way. We're in the matrix.
Absolutely.
Okay? Whether you're a house Negro or a field Negro, you're still a slave, okay? Somebody gets a better plate of food doesn't mean you better. You know what I mean? It's all relative.
Right.
And, the European O negative was a clone of the original Cosmo somebody goes better into that. They were cloned specifically from, like, the Egyptian bloodline to purposefully be utilized to be almost like a parolees to watch over the melanated people who they could not control. So they were created for that. So if anything pops off in our environment, like terrorism, you know, pseudo-terrorism, the first people who would be most likely to believe it because of the mind control are the O-negative Europeans. And most of, I would even take a synopsis that most of the Republican Party are O-negative. That's what I think. I don't know.
Wow. And I mean, all of this sounds so, I mean, it just relates. And I want to bring up, too, a long time ago I had met this young lady, and she was telling me how she had a friend that was a police officer, and he worked, he was doing some off-duty work, and it was this club called The Crucible, and he was doing work there, and he was just being security. But he noticed that in order to get in this place, it was downtown D.C., so in order to get in this place, you had to give a passcode. And so everything was taking place, all the activities was taking place on the bottom, in the basement floor. But he was saying that there were politicians there, there were, like, judges, like, all these prestigious people there. And when he went downstairs, he was like, he saw things that he couldn't even speak of. He was, like, going on, like, people doing some abominable things to each other down there, you know. And these were, like, very high flying politicians and people of prestige all down on that basement floor doing things. It was blood involved, feces, urine. It was all that involved down there. Yeah. So I was going to ask you, what is the purpose in all of those kind of, like, grotesque things going on? What are they getting out of, you know, doing those type of things with each other? What is it, a certain energy that's being raised by them interacting like that, or, you know, what could be possibly going on?
It's not being connected to source, not having a soul. That's soulless behavior. A lot of that is beast behavior because you have no connection to the Akashic records. That's why because you have a depreciation of melanin, and again, there's black people who do some depraved things too. I'm saying, in general, most of the politicians and stuff we're talking about are of European background. A lot of them are numb, and we talked about this, not being sensitive, and it's just like a cutter. You ever heard of people cutting themselves because they feel numb?
Yeah.
It's the same thing. If you don't feel, you do extreme things to get feeling, because it doesn't feel real to you. So you do, sometimes it starts off, maybe they started off as cutters, maybe, and they're ritualistic, because a lot of, if you're a politician, first of all, I question if you're human anyway, if you're a politician. They choose those politicians. Because home court advantage is changing, and we'll talk about that later, but if you were a politician and you were in rulership of a state or part of the Congress or Senate, what have you, I would question you having a soul, number one, or you being human. Because I know for a fact that 90% of who's on that top tier are not human, or they're without a soul. One and the same to me. They have no empathy for humanity or for any indigenous people from here. So they can do stuff like that. It's beastly behavior. But if you're not connected to divine, to your divinity, because you have no soul, souls feel things. Even if they do depraved things, they feel it. There's a connection, like, oh, my God, I know this is wrong. Even if they feel, they have that. So it prevents them from doing too many bad things. But someone who has no soul has no connection, and they have no empathy. There's no sympathy, empathy. There's nothing. They're numb. And they can do anything and not feel a goddamn thing. Excuse my language.
Well, please.
And that's why you see them do extreme things, orgies, because they're numb. I'm not saying everybody who does orgies is I gotta disappear. No, I'm just saying they're numb. They're doing extreme things to try to feel because they have no connection.
Right. Wow. So desensitized. And it seems like this is the reality that they're trying to push upon the, you know, melanated people as well. I mean, look at us now. I mean, it's so many things that we're participating in that, you know, you wouldn't think.
Well, we're mimicking Massa. Yeah, but we mimicking Massa. And it's, and I, yeah, you know, if he's eating good, he's eating high on a hog, and we see we're not, some of that, we're going to mimic it, you know, just because we think that's the best. And I give a little bit of a pass, not too much, to our people who've been so depraved and abused. I do. Because if you put someone in a state of desperation all the time and a low self, a sense of self-worth, they're going to act that way. You know, they're going to mimic those depraved creatures who put them in that state of being.
Okay, okay. Wow. So what can we do to elevate our vibrations? And if we feel like the Archon is on us, or they're trying to put negative thoughts in our minds, what can we do to shield ourselves from that?
The first thing you could do is express self-love daily. And I know people hate when I say this, but it is so true. Do what you love to do at least once a day. If it means sitting down and reading a book like you used to when you were a kid, do it. If it means brushing your hair and conditioning it and feeling good for maybe 20 minutes alone and just watching a bad show, do it. Showing, expressing self-love raises your vibration. Laughing, watching comedy shows that are not depreciative to your soul, but are just based in laughter and happiness that brings joy to you, that's raising your vibration. Now, you know how I feel about nutrition, so I'm going to say it because this is what I do.
Do you, Fleurbrun? We love it. Go ahead.
You know, if you eat death every day, your life is going to be reminiscent of it. Hello. You know, if you don't got canines and claws, your ass should not be eating dead flesh. And we're not eating flesh that's been killed yesterday. We're eating corpses that's been dead for weeks or months.
And just sitting in the meat factory.
With all kinds of entities putting their vibration on it, putting their take of chemical on it, you're eating death. If you want to live a good life, you got to eat what brings life, chlorophyll, anything that's happy. Fruit makes you happy. If you eat, I remember times when, especially when I was pregnant, I'd be, like, I feel a certain way, and I just crave an orange, and I eat the orange, and I felt like it was heaven. Eating fruits and vegetables, and I say, listen, I'm a healthy girl, I look healthy, and I like to eat. I make the most fabulous food, but you got to stop eating dead corpses and flesh. And I know people don't like when I say it, and I'm sorry, but it is the truth. If you eat of death, your life will be reminiscent of it. What goes for one goes for the other. And also, if you don't want to be fed off of by vampires, you shouldn't be feeding off of other life. What goes around comes around. It's all karmic based. So when you release yourself from harming, allowing a mother to be a bled to death and milk to death, and her baby can't feed from her, a cow, and that baby's dragged away, and you eat the flesh of that mother and that baby, there's a price to pay for that karmically, and we're living it in our daily lives. So I know it's hard, but it's the truth, and it's a sick world, but it was created by Archons. We did not eat like this in ancient times. We did not. And if an animal was slayed, it was given respect. It was done once in a while, and there was a ritual involved so that that soul could be released. It wasn't just killing, letting other people kill animals, and these animals would be living in squalor and all that kind of thing. You pay for that. You pay for allowing another life. And Europeans are paying now for allowing us to not do well in life either. Karma's a bitch.
It sure is. It sure is.
So that's another way to raise your vibration. Yeah. Start eating well. Start clearing out your water. Start not consuming things like fluoride. Start filtering out your own water. Start telling your water you love it, because that's a vibration. Water is highly vibrational. start eating more. When I say salads and stuff, eat more, just more things that you like. There's a lot of fruits and vegetables. There's so many raw recipes, and there's so many recipes of vegetarian-wise. We're living in good times right now. You can get anything that's mock, that tastes like what it was, because meat doesn't taste like it was anyway. That's why we put all these herbs on it. You put all vegetables on it anyway just to make it not taste like flesh. That's crazy.
Wow. So back in the day, it was probably more flavorful because of what they went through to prepare it and bless it and those type of things.
Absolutely. And it wasn't daily. If we consumed meat, and many of us didn't, but if we came from tribes that consumed any flesh, it was done quickly. It was done maybe once or twice a month. We didn't have dead flesh sitting on our stomachs for over a period of time. That lowers your vibration. Now, another thing that lowers your vibration is drinking liquor. And, you know, I love tequila. If anybody knows me, you know, I like tequila. You know, once a month maybe. And, you know, I go dancing, so you already know. But I think I was on another show and we were talking about, we're thinking they're doing something to the vibration of the liquid in the liquor. Because when I drank, this is a while ago, I remember drinking something, I felt my vibration drop. And it usually doesn't do that. And I was like, oh, my God, they're doing something vibratory to lower the frequency of the liquid in that liquor. It's crazy. Mm. They can do that. They can do that by putting tones on it. Yeah.
It's like they say malt liquor is tampered with. Like they do something to the malt liquor and put it in the neighborhood.
Yes. Yes. I've seen them on OE. It's not a good sight. I'm serious.
Wow.
You have to be mindful of consuming any drug and any prescription drug included in that. People tend to think marijuana is a beautiful thing. It can be, but marijuana is better eaten or taken in another form, like almost like a tea, as opposed to smoking it. Because not only does it lower your vibration, it lowers your susceptibility of getting diseases.
Yes, it's better when you do not heat it. Once you heat it, then you release all the good properties in it. But if it's taken in a juice or, you know, put in a smoothie, it has so many good properties that can help heal the body and do great things for you. So
absolutely. It cures a lot of things, too, cannabis. So, it does a lot of wonderful things. But, again, things like cocaine. Cocaine is another drug that they put. Now, I had a conversation with this because you have a lot. I didn't realize because I moved to a warm air in Florida, but cocaine is a big thing for a lot of these people here. And cocaine is not, it is one of those drugs that they put so many other chemicals in with that alone lowers your immune system and it lowers your vibration. I've noticed that more possessions come from people who are doing cocaine than any other drug. This is what I've seen personally.
Okay.
Why, I don't know. I think it's a mixture of whatever they're putting in there, but for some reason, cocaine is more so than heroin. Heroin, I don't see as many possessions, but I do see it with cocaine. Don't know why.
Yeah, I know up here where we live at, like, cocaine is not like, well, I mean, to my knowledge, I might just be ignorant to the fact, but I've never really met anybody that does cocaine, like the snorting and stuff like that up here. I don't know if it's hard to get up here or what, but marijuana is more, like, big up here.
Cocaine is coming from the Spanish Latin American country. So I live in the middle of Puerto Rico, you know, like Florida, you know, Orlando, Florida. A lot of the Latinos bring that element to it.
So
that's probably why it's more prevalent.
Right. And another thing we need to talk about before we get off is these soul contracts. Fleurbrun, can you go into what is a soul contract and why do we sign it and why?
Why did I sign that damn contract? I don't like it.
Why do we sign a damn contract? Please let us know why.
when we're on the other side, a lot of us are on the karmic wheel. And I don't like to use that word, but I'm going to use it just for explanation. we're on a karmic wheel. And what it is we're learning. We're spiritually learning. This is a school as well. So when we pass away, we generally tend to stay in circles of people we've known for many, 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 many lifetimes. We generally stay in the same circle. Mm-hmm. And let's say me and you are friends, right, and I've harmed you. I created havoc for your family. I just lied to you. I hurt you. When we pass away, and that's not been resolved here, we go up and I say, oh, girl, you know, we talked to you. Oh, I haven't seen you in a long time. Oh, you did me dirty. So what? No, you know, there's no judgment up there. It's kind of like, okay, I see how that feels. You know what? I want to switch and put myself in your place and see what that experience is so I can learn from it and grow from it. So when we decide to make a contract with one another that instead of you being the recipient of pain, that we flip it and I make a contract that I deliver that or somebody else does it for you to learn that experience that you've impended on me. It's all for learning. And you make a soul contract with other souls based on your need to learn something new that would open you up or to make you more spiritually heightened. That's all that's about. But it sounds good until you come down to earth. You gotta play it
and
out.
Experience the shit.
You gotta live up to that contract. But what you'll see a lot of times, and that's why you shouldn't judge racial, you know, as much as we talk about race, if we keep it real, a lot of times anyone who's experiencing a heightened sense of prejudice or racial bias, chances are in their past life, they have impended that same racial bias on someone else. So they are here. A lot of the old white southern people have come back as black people, and you'd be like, this black person isn't very conscious. They don't sound conscious because they come back from those racist slave owners, and they're experiencing what they've given to those people. And also they get to feel the depreciation of the generations of what happens to the people that they've done this to. And now they're in black form, experiencing deprivation, discrimination, depreciation of character. So we can't judge it sometimes. You don't know what a soul has come here and what contract they've made. We come here with spiritual contracts from not only personal people, but we come on sometimes there's geographical karma and contracts too. We come to certain regions to solidify or to reap what we've sown in another life.
Okay. Can you tell us, you know how when we reincarnate, maybe we might reincarnate as a baby that dies, and to us in the human form, it seems like, oh, so sad, so bad, and we're experiencing it and the pain and the hurt. But can you like kind of describe like how that plays into this life? Yeah, this life is like a split second in time. Like, really, it's no such thing as time, but we just feel like we're locked into the time paradox that we're, you know, going through day by day, going to work, having these experiences, but it's really not as long as it seems, as we feel like it. You know, we feel like we're living like 70 years and that's a long time, but really things are just really happening with a blink of an eye, like, because time doesn't exist.
It doesn't. And that's from the Archons. Thanks to Archons for that. Time is to lock us in. They create time, so we're locked in. That's our chains. That's our bolts and chains. They created that to give us a concept of being restricted by time all the time. That's part of their construct. When they created this matrix, they created time in order to give us the illusion of having to go through a series of things, and it seems long. It's not real. As far as a baby coming in and passing away, I want to speak to that. I had a long conversation with a girlfriend over this, too. A lot of times if people have had children or children that have not come to be, I will say this, and again, I'm pro-life. I'm pro-all life. Number one, I love everything. I love trees. You know, I'm appreciative of everything. So when I speak to this, I just say a lot of women struggle of maybe having abortions when they were younger or doing things, or a baby passing away, maybe they had a miscarriage. From what I know is that a soul knows if it's going to be solidified in the matrix. And if it knows that it will not be, because remember, time doesn't exist, so it already knows if it's going to come to fruition or not. Mm-hmm. It will not insert itself into that mother. So that baby will not have what we consider to be a spark soul when it is there. But there is a contract sometimes with that parent to have that experience sometimes. Mm-hmm. The mother may have to experience the feeling of loss. And again, we don't know what the contracts are for. We don't know that if another lifetime a mother was consistently doing harmful things to children and then she comes back into another life and she has to experience not being able to have them or lose them. You know what I mean? So we can't speak to it because we don't know what her soul contract is with these the pregnancies coming in through her. But as far as I know, and it's not to relieve anyone, again, I'm pro-choice, but I will say this. I personally know to be, and again, this could change based on something information I can get in the future, souls are not sparked until about the last trimester.
Okay.
And again, anything coming through the vortex or the stargate of the mother knows if it's going to be solidified into the matrix. So if it's not going to survive, chances are there's no spark soul, from what I know. So if that relieves any mothers or girls or young people or, you know, who had babies pass away before birth or typically after or, maybe by termination, you know, if that relieves them, that, you know, I hope so.
So it was pretty much already written what was going to happen. So
Absolutely. They know it's coming. You know, the soul comes in. When it knows, it's like, oh, it's ready.
Right.
It knows, you know. So, but again, there's soul contracts upon that, you know, before you come in. And those soul contracts can be broken, too. Let's talk about breaking those. Oh, God.
If you dare.
I think Dolores Cannon, who I really, really enjoy listening to, she's done a couple lectures here online. I like her. She was a psychiatrist. Yeah, she talks about regression. Soul contracts, if, let's say, you're in a life, and I'll use it as a husband or a wife, Cretan. You know, it's just hard. But you made a soul contract with this mofo. And you're like, oh, darn. You just make this contract all the harder. You're not supposed to come in here, like, strongholding to everything. And let's just say you feel that this is too heavy for you.
Mm-hmm.
It's too heavy for you to endure, and you don't feel like maybe you can survive from that. You can spiritually say to yourself, you can actually just verbally say to yourself, I end the contract I have with you spiritually. I choose to end it. That's it. And you can, some people like the visualization, which works if you're not really good at manifesting. So you visually see a cord connected to that person, or you see a piece of paper and you rip it up in your mind, a contract between you and you, and you break it, and it works. It works. I always say if you break that contract, you don't want to have to make up a contract with somebody else or have to live out another contract. Sometimes it's better to ride out whatever needs to be learned. And once you learn it, that person or that energy or that negativity goes away. It disappears.
Okay.
So sometimes if it's one of two things. If you feel like you can't live through it and you feel like you're going to die if you have to smell the sulfur on that dude's breath, I say break the contract and call it a day. Now, if you feel like you're strong enough and you would prefer to learn the lesson now than to have to reincarnate or come back and deal with another worse person, I would say to yourself, you know, I choose to learn the lesson that this contract was created for me to learn, and you'll get it quicker. So once you get what you were there to learn, it goes away because you're projecting it. Your contract is your own creation. You created this situation. So once you resolve it, that's why a lot of times when people go through regression, psychological regression, when they go in their past lives, they realize that something in their past life was traumatic, and once they talk about it in the regression, the situation in their real life now goes away because they resolved it.
Mm-hmm.
They resolved it. You know, acknowledgement.
Is there any way, like, when we reincarnate, if we reincarnate again, will we have any consciousness that we clear that contract in another life, or would it just be, you know, maybe just more easier for us in certain areas of our life the next incarnation?
Well, this is the trap, and this is when we go back into the Archons. We really
okay.
don't have to live out contracts or karma in anything. That's actually all an illusion that we're co-signing to. We really don't have to. They create this for us to feel like we have to go through the wheel of karma. That is not necessary for you to learn anything. You don't even have to. You're an old soul anyway. You know everything. You just forgot it. That's why.
Right.
You just forgot. You know all this stuff already. It's like taking a pop quiz. You already know what they're going to ask you. You already know the answers. So the karma thing, the wheels of karma, the entrapment of the souls, I think Gary kind of went in that Littleton, when they trap our souls here so we don't pass, we don't go further to pass a certain frequency, and then we're trapped in the wheel, you know, like above, we're trapped in the ether so that we can't get out of here, and then they throw us back in, and we're forced to deal with all the karmic, you know, go back into the wheel of reincarnation over and over again. It's not necessary. It's really not.
Okay.
That's part of the Archon. They trap you here
okay.
so that you feel like you have to. You don't have to do anything. Everything's relative. You don't have to pay anybody back. Everything, if the pendulum goes right, you know for a fact it's going to come back left. You just have
okay.
to stay somewhere in the middle so you're not feeling the ebb and flow. You're staying balanced.
Wow.
That's
okay.
the problem with us.
Wow. It kind of reminds me, I was on this website called 5D, and there was this guy named Cameron something, and he was writing about how the Archons put us in this, like, cycle of reincarnation over and over. Like, when you die, they, like, kind of give you a brief synopsis of your life and then send you back in. It's like a meal or something.
Yes, they give you a briefing. They give you a briefing before they sentence you to another 100 years of hell. Yes.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. You don't have to do it.
Oh, God. So how can we consciously be aware when we pass over to the next side not to go to the light?
Ah.
Don't go to
okay.
the light.
This is important, and I hope everybody listens to this. And I love that, oh, my crown is shooting up and vibrating. It's very important. Because you will remember what I say to you when you cross over. When you cross over, there's a light. And what happens is that they give an artificial light with illusions of your family members waiting down a hallway for you, summoning you to greet you and love you and reconnect with them. That's the lie. That's a lie. Do not go down that hallway and don't go to that light. That's the false light. That's the light that they tell you to stay away from. Where you do go is you stay quiet in the darkness, and you will feel. It's the difference. Don't go for what you see. You will feel a beat, a vibration, and you will feel something. It almost looks like a some people say it's kind of like a rainbow looking, like a faint rainbow. That's the glow. You don't go towards the light. You go towards like a light glow. And it will. You'll feel the toning. Like I heard it's like a beat, like almost like a heartbeat or music. That's what you go towards, but you got to stay still. People get really scared when they pass on, and they're confused. And that's, you know, and that's the problem with us not knowing who we are in this life, because we go in the other world and we're just lost.
Right.
And we're susceptible for the Archons to just trap our asses and send us back here. If you go towards that hallway in the light with your family, you will never come back to them again. You will go back into the wheel of karma and come back here and do another cycle. I guarantee you. When you go up there, you have to stay still. That's why meditation is important for you now. If you're not the type of person who could stay still, you will go up there and you will get so anxious and so desperate to go towards things that you were lacking. That's why when you go up there, you wait. And you will see the right one, but you can't go to the one that directly is there. As soon as you go up there, the light is already there. They're waiting for you. The show has already started. The curtain's
wow.
open.
Wow. The horse
they're waiting to trap
them.
You. They're waiting to trap you. And those people are not your family members. They're all illusions. They're a hologram. You're not your family. Your family does not meet you over there. They're not allowed to. That's what people don't know. There's a doorway that you go through, and that's when you meet maybe any ancestors on the other side, their spirit. Some of their souls are here, but you may see their spirit up there. But you won't see that until you go through the it's like a stargate. Like a little, and you'll feel very naturally pulled into there, and it will you'll feel love, but you won't feel it until you go to your own vibration, your own light source. But if you go to the other one, it's going to brief you, tell you what you're going to do. You're going to make your contracts, and you're going to come right back down.
I mean, this is really like life down here on Earth. I mean, for our listeners, things start in the spirit before they manifest in the physical. So that's why it seems so familiar, like, wow, this is the stuff we go through on a maybe daily basis down here, signing contracts, not reading
mm-hmm.
them, not reading the fine print, getting caught up. So
highly religious people have the hardest time when they get up there because they have a perfect show for religious people. Jesus shows up. If they don't go quick enough, Jesus shows up.
Mm.
And they will go. Because they've been indoctrinated, and that indoctrination is even with them when they're up there.
Wow. And you know, when I was in my Christian mode a long time ago, there was this woman, and she would, like, say that she would go into, you know, they're very careful how they use the words because, you know, if it's not biblical, then it's the devil.
Oh, yeah.
How she used her wording, but she was like, yeah, I will go visit heaven. I'll go into, she wouldn't say meditation, but she would just say God will take her in a state of ecstasy, and she'll go up into the heavens, and she would see roller coasters and merry-go-rounds and all these things.
That sounds like abduction. That sounds like alien abduction.
Right, all her family members are up there. She's eating big juicy peaches, all these things, you know. And then you know, now I'm thinking back like, wow, you know, it was a deception because
mm-hmm.
one thing I noticed is that Christians talk about is that there's going to be this great deception going on. And
mm-hmm.
if you're not on this side of the fence, then you're going to get sucked into that great deception. But it's like the great deception is pretty much
what they're already living in.
Right.
Yeah. I'm about to make a video to my Christian set. Big up to the Christian crew. I'm
going to
make videos just for y'all about Stockholm Syndrome because a lot of you suffer from it, and we need to discuss it because I want my brothers and sisters to be free. And they stuck in this sociological condition called Stockholm Syndrome, and they got to be released from it because all they're going to do is create more havoc in their life, and it'll create havoc for some of us.
And I'm telling you, I was in a nail salon and there was a Christian lady in there. She's talking and she was like, yeah, you know, I mean, she's talking about people in her church like dogs. And then she,
oh, wow.
You know, and she's loud
religious.
About it.
She sounds religious. Yeah. She ain't going to heaven. She ain't going to heaven. I ain't gonna do it. Mm-mm.
Oh wow! It's
such
all this.
I would like some of the people who are listening also, Brother Panic, who I am an admirer of. This brother is beyond comprehension, and he'll break it down to the minuscule of consciousness. And again, he's the one who's really not a fan of the word karma because everything is relative. You can't really judge anything. You got to be mindful not to look at something
mm-hmm.
to judge it. You don't. Everything is for a reason. And
mm-hmm.
that's why when you
mm-hmm.
see somebody getting an ass whooped, you don't know why they're getting an ass whooped.
Right.
Not to say it's justifiable, but you may not want to intercede unless you know exactly where that's coming from. You don't know if they stabbed somebody, killed somebody's mother. You don't know.
Right.
Stay out of things that do not concern you on a personal basis.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Everything you see on television with race and everything is not what it seems. It is an illusion, and it's meant to invoke us. That's what
mm-hmm.
they do.
Mm-hmm.
Well, a lot of black people were being killed years ago. They didn't televise it. Why now? There's a reason
right.
for that. Why
right.
now? Whose benefit is it? For ours? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. It's to put fear in us. Like, look, nigga, excuse my language. Look at you. You better stay in line. Master used to be one slave and whip him in front of, what, everybody, right, as an example. Remember that. Why did he do that? Because if you even had a thought, you looking at that man getting his butt beat to the point where he could not move again, you were going to damn sure make sure you didn't do anything to go against him. That is what them showing us being shot like dogs in the street are. This has always happened. They are televising it to keep us in line because they know the party's over. Their reign of terror is done. Their home court advantage, once we got a black president, that was the ETs who declared that. We had to have a melanated man when the shift happened because now it's going back to the original. Sorry.
Right. Yeah, it's like history repeating itself all over again. Because I'm like, growing up, I remember it was like a period of, I didn't even hear anything about all this race and who's dark, who's black. I mean, I never experienced that. And then I'm like, wow, now? Why are they bringing this back up?
And the only people bringing it up are the people on television.
Yeah.
They're doing it. They're sparking it. And who's running it? That's where we have to be very clear about perpetuating or feeling invoked by it because it's not real. I'm not saying that the man really didn't die, but that could have been an old video. I saw on my newsfeed on FB, they were showing, like, old feeds of people getting their butt beat, like, from years ago. And then it was, like, oh, putting in the newsfeed like it was new to invoke us. So, you know, It always happened. They've harmed us. That's what they did. But we need to come from a different space that if they're doing this now on a mass level, they're fearful of something. That means that we have more power than we even know. And something's about to pop off with us. And we're already seeing it with our level of consciousness rising.
Now how does Israel play a role in all this? What is so special? And I've heard in that video that you sent me of Ross, Brother Ross Ben, and he it's called Is It Real? Israel, Is It Real? Is It Real? What is the whole stigma around Israel? What is it?
I'll give you my personal opinion on this because I have a strong connection to Israel. Don't know why, always did. I have a feeling that why they went and hijacked Israel is because I believe there's like some sort of big stargate there, or it's where our ancestors were in a real sense. I mean, I'm talking about black Negroids. I got to say that because, you know, people will try to change Negroids. We were there. I have a feeling that during the time of the true Exodus, it's just something that comes to my soul. I always felt like that would be the place that we were meant to go. To go back home. I think there's a huge stargate there, I'm being honest. And I think that they knew that that was our home base, where we would go, where we would have to do our exodus. And what they did is they kind of barred us from doing it, and they went there and hijacked it. So we couldn't go back home. We couldn't go there if we had to leave. I think they just did that. And that's why they're paying for it with skin cancer. They're about to be taken over. That's why they're surrounded by their enemies. They're parasitic vampires that went over there, Nazis, Ashkenazis living there, and I think they're doing it so that we can't go home. I believe that's the original Zion. This is my personal opinion. I think that's where Zion, that's where we can either go to Zion, or I think that's where it is. And I think they knew it, and that's why they made sure that they incepted themselves there so that we would not be able to go there.
Okay.
And they had to bring black people over there because the 12 tribes, supposedly the 12 tribes of the original people, the indigenous people on the planet, were supposed to go back to, supposed to meet together at Zion. This is like some old, you know, the Rastafarians talk about this. I love when they talk about it. You know, they're supposed to return to Zion and repent. And really the 12 tribes are all the brown people from all the corners of the earth. We were all on the earth, everywhere, cold, warm, everywhere. It was all brown people. And I believe we came different sets of hybrids. And I think we were supposed to come together at one point, and I think they knew it would probably be Israel. That's my personal opinion. Many people have other, but that's my, I felt that way.
Okay. So it's like with the like the Hebrew Israelites, I want to say.
I don't want to mess with the Hebrew Israelites, y'all.
Is this connected? Because I know they go through the Moor history.
They got a lot of knowledge, but them brothers be coming for blood.
Yes.
I
just took it as, you know, I respect them at that level of consciousness that they're on right there, because everybody has their place.
And they're aggressive towards women, boy. They're not for that divine femininity. They anti.
Mm-mm. Oh, yeah.
No. I would say to a sister, if you're going to date one of them Hebrew Israelites, just make sure you've got gear on you, because you know what I'm in for. I say, wow. I'm sorry.
That's funny you say that, because I saw one go off on a woman in a group the other day, and he was saying, I thought this group was about uplifting our people, and you women need to learn to stay in your place, and this and that. I'm like, what?
They're hostile. And none of them ever have a woman with them. You never see them with women. I think they might be, you know, borderline homosexuals who hate women. I personally think, I'm sorry. I take that back. I'm sorry.
It's
That's a judgment. I don't know.
It's funny because my friend's parents, they're like in their 70s, and they just converted over to being Hebrew Israelites, and they're very anti-Caucasian, and they're like up in the age, you know. I don't know who converted them, but they're very anti. Loosen up, people. Remember, we wrote these stories. Loosen up, you know. Everything doesn't have to be so serious.
Right.
I've studied the Torah, the Talmud, and learned some Hebrew. That's why I say I felt a connection. In my past life, I felt a high connection to Israel. That's why I say I have something there. But really, the Torah and the Talmud go into some of the historical reasons why there was to be an exodus. And I personally don't believe that the Jews were slaves in Egypt. I think that was made up by Europeans, personally. Because when you speak to certain other Africans, they don't even have that history. They don't even have a notion of that occurring in anything, in any of their texts or any of the books or any of the, you know, their spiritual books as well. But if you read the book of the Rastafari, you know, I very much respect the Rastafari and their Hebrew linkage to a lot of things, and if you start to study some of their information in their books and their literature, it really talks about our connection that, you know, again, a lot of who we are has been lost in history because it's been hijacked and changed. And they were saying that a lot of us are linked to that what we consider Hebrew connection. I think it's all the same. We separate Hebrew and Arabic. I think it's all one. I think that Europeans just dissects everything and makes everything separate and compartmentalizes everything. I really don't think it's all one and the same, to be honest.
Okay. So, you know, because my big thing is, why is there racism when, if they claim we all come from Africa, the African. But then, and then when you do the research, it's like we've been on every part of the earth there is already before you started writing your history. So it's kind of like really stupid to me that we, you know, categorize people as this person is Italian, this person is Spanish, this person is African.
It's not
but
us.
We all, but
it's not
know,
us.
Right. So, but the Caucasian, they come from us, right? Are they like a hybrid of us?
They've been grafted with our genealogy, yes. They've been grafted from us.
Okay. So it's just irritating to me.
But they've been altered.
Like, I'm mixed with this, I'm mixed with that. I'm like, what?
What it is that, and that's why people of color, we have the biggest issue, because they lump us together as one. The color of our skin does not denote our race or our genealogy. It really doesn't. We were all brown people. You had Eskimos who were dark and brown and beautiful living in the cold regions. You had the Cherokees who were dark black living, what is in the Dakotas, and oh, what is the Cherokees are in the Midwest. You had the black-footed Indians who looked like straight-up Negroes. You had the Seminole. I mean, we lived in cold regions. That's what I'm saying. This European, the, when I say European, I'm talking about the 1% who is in power. I'm not talking about the ones who are living with us, you know, in our world, because the only people that matter are the 1% who are in power, who are delegating these racial delineations of each other. That does not exist. We did not have racial. Race is not based on your complexion. You got the, the Aborigines over in Australia live in a whole different world over on the other side. But then you have, when you go to Hawaii, you have the Hawaiians who look very reminiscent of me and a couple other people with skin tone, things, hair texture, everything, with wider nose, bigger lips. And these are people living on all different spectrums. And then you have Native Americans living in Canada in the coldest region. You have the Mongols. We know it's not true. They've created their own history based on lies to make themselves seem like they're bigger than life. And I get it, because maybe if I was in that position, maybe I'd want to keep a sense of that I'm superior. You know, I may have not done it. I can see why they do it. I can understand. But we cannot fall victim to that, because not all black people are the same, as we know with Hebrew Israelites. You know, not everybody comes from the same. We're very different. Very different. And because that's why we have a problem getting along with each other, because we're not all the same. And a lot of, you know, I tell people there's GMOs that are white people, but there's some GMO black people that don't have souls.
Okay.
And you meet them and you see them, and they are devils. They're mean-spirited. They have no empathy and lack consciousness. And we got to be mindful not to lump ourselves in groups with people that have no sense of anything connected to us. And that's why we fail. Go to like-minded people who have same values and ethics as yourself, and generally the same consciousness. You got to do that. Don't just fall in the boat with any old black person, because they're different.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. And if you raise your consciousness, won't you attract people that's on your same frequency?
Well, you will, but remember, we got Archons working along, too. So they send agents. Okay? Yeah. Because Malcolm X didn't die from having, you know, bad black folks. He had agents around that were sent for him. Same with Martin Luther King. You know, a lot of people have had, what everybody who's doing good, they see that they will send agents. So you will have maybe a lot of people who are like you that you're magnetizing to, that you'll feel connection to, but they will send some agents in the mix to mess with you. And you have to be able to discern them, you know, who they are.
Wow. And if they're coming to you as a sweet, innocent little child.
There's no innocent child, according to Dr. Crookman. No. She stated no. And it really messed with me for a while, and then I overstood what she was stating. She was saying, if a child is being harmed and so on, you don't know who that soul is, because even though it's a child, remember, it was a soul. And it came from an adult in another lifetime. You don't know what that is. You don't know what they're here for. So if a child appears sweet but is doing wicked things, you don't know what that is. And possession can happen a lot with children, especially who come from wombs of people who are depreciated. So you got to be careful.
Girl, I believe it. I work with preschoolers, and I see how that, whatever it is, it jumps around the classroom with certain kids. It's like... They're devious. Oh my God! And then they come real. That's why I asked you, because I'm like, wow, certain kids that come off really innocent and sweet, and then they do the devious thing.
Possession.
Wow.
And also, you got to realize, I think, it's a while. We were talking about wombs that have generational demons that come along with certain bloodlines. So. If you get a depreciative mother, sometimes it's just a matter of her just being depreciative and she didn't spark a soul because she didn't have any spark in her left to spark a soul in her womb to create a soul baby. If there's no soul coming out with that child that's born, something else will take that a place in that body. It's an empty vessel, and there's a lot of entities that want to be in a vessel right now on the planet.
Wow.
Okay? So if she's given birth, maybe she was maybe the mother was traumatized. She's a drug addict. Maybe she was raped a lot of times. Demons are also passed through the vagina from the penis. Girls have to be very mindful of who they sleep with.
Mm-hmm.
You know, tattoos are also vortexes into other realms. And if you get demonic tattoos, you have attachments of demons to you. And if you sleep with a man who has demonic tattoos, he inserts a demon inside of you. And if you ever give birth, that entity, that energy, that low vibration is in your womb. And it attaches to your baby. I mean, that's why you see certain children now, along with drugs and alcohol, who lower your vibration and make you more susceptible to attachments from entities attaching to those children. It's very easy.
I believe it.
Yeah, okay. Exercise children, people. Stage them, smudge them.
I might have to go in the classroom with my smudge stick. I mean, really, because these little...
You got clowns. I mean, but that's...
The boy, he wouldn't blink for 5 minutes straight. I'm like, what is going on here? I mean, he was in that manic mood, you know, demonic mood, and he's sitting over there. We're like, oh my God, he doesn't blink. He would not blink his eyes.
Oh,
like,
that's another sign. Thank you for saying that. That's a sign of a demon. Yeah, not blinking. Or a robotoid. That's something else, though. Yeah.
Oh, geez. And I swear to you, when I encounter certain kids in my class that are in that mood, it feels like I'm warping, if that's a word. Like, I mean, like, I feel like my face is warping or changing. Like, our energies are not mixing. So I feel my face, like, warp, like, change just by being in their presence. Like, I'm trying to... Yeah, it feels weird, and I'm like, how is this happening? You know, is it? And that's when I kind of recognize, okay, this child might have some sort of possession, something going on, because I'm like, I can't even keep a straight face when I'm in their presence because of the entity, and then it's like they'll switch, like you were talking about the bipolar thing, like they would like switch. Too good, and oh hi so and so, you know, and then they'll be back.
Oh,
into
yeah, different personalities.
What is going on? I feel like I'm in a matrix. I just sit there and have to witness everything.
But what's crazy about it is that back in the days, maybe our grandparents, let's say, they knew that when children were possessed because they used to clean them, they used to cleanse them, they used to do rituals to clean a baby or put protection around a baby. We don't do that anymore. People just bring babies from the hospital and don't protect them. Don't put a spiritual blessing over them. They'll baptize them and consider that spirituality, but you don't know what you're putting on with that, whatever that baptism is, you know. But we don't protect our babies with you know, blessings and herbs and smudging them. That's what we used to do. So now these children are susceptible to anything. Listen, I have little people, and I smudge them, cleanse them. I make sure my doorways are sealed. If you come in this house, you come to a goddess's house. You better check yourself before you wreck yourself. You ain't coming through the door. And if you bring some in the house, that entity is going to be dealt with well.
Right.
Don't play with them. Entities need to be dealt with. And if you ever, you know, I know you're in a school, you're restricted, but I've seen ceremonies where people will speak to the spirit because the spirit has anonymity. And a lot of times the entity will live there cohesively because it's not acknowledged. And it will just live like a parasite and a vampire, like it's feeding off your child or somebody's family. But if you speak to it, that's the first thing they tell you. Speak to the demon. You need to go. And they'd be looking at you like, who are you talking to? I'm talking to you. You need to bounce. You are here. You were uninvited. And if I got to take care of you, you're not going to have anywhere to go to. So I suggest you leave on your own, or I'm going to take care of you. You have to speak to those entities. I know people think it's crazy, but it's not. That's what many African tribes used to do. They made rituals of it.
Wow. Now, you know one thing I was thinking about, dear, I don't know if you know about, it's this preacher from Africa, and his name is T.B. Joshua. I don't know if you've seen any of his little ceremonies, but it's like he'll have these ceremonies, and they'll be in like big auditoriums, and it's in Africa, or it might be in London or somewhere overseas. But he has this thing where he just walks in the room and he might wave his hands, and allegedly demons come out of the person. The people be convulsing all on the floors. They say they have marine spirits. A lot of people will come up and they'll say, oh, yeah, I was possessed by a marine spirit, meaning that it was somebody that was from the sea or that they were married to a spirit. And you have to look him up, T.B. Joshua. Because, we were on our, you know, Christian kit. We would watch his videos, and we were like, wow, you know, this seems very strange because all the African women would be convulsing, like, in one room. Like, he would just walk in the room, and he says that they're being released from the demon. Okay. And they're just like, I mean, moving, you could tell it's not them moving, like whatever's in them is just moving around. Mm-hmm. And I was just like, wow, what is going on? I've been baffled by the whole thing because I also heard of a guy that was saying that in Africa that there is a city under the sea that a lot of people in Africa go to when they leave their body. It's like some sort of city under the sea with all these different things there. And his guy had given testimony. He was saying, yeah, I had left my body. Me and his father used to take him. He said they'll go by the seashore, and they would leave their bodies, and they'll just walk in the sea in the spirit. And he said he'll turn back and see him and his father just sitting there on the seashore, but their spirit is actually going underneath the waters and going inside of the earth. And they're experiencing things. They're like extra children and all of this. And so when you watch, if you get a chance to watch T.B. Joshua, he's expelling these demons, what he calls demons, marine spirits, that are like causing havoc on a lot of these people who are married. They'll say that they're married to different spirits. They see spiritual children and under the sea. It's really strange because we never heard of this until, you know, we were on our little Christian mission. But I always think back to it because I'm like, what was that? Like, was that real? Like, what's going on with that? Have you ever heard of that? Like, the Marines?
I mean, I've seen that. And I don't ever that it's not real. I think it's as real as the people believe it is. If a person is strong, held in their belief, and they believe that this person can free them from something in them, the entity inside of them will believe it too. So it could be he's exercising them. I haven't seen it, but I've seen that happen. Yeah, it could be very well that he's releasing demons out of people, and that's usually a sign when they're convulsing and stuff like that, you know. But then you do have things like mass hysteria too. So, you know, we have to be mindful when you're doing things in such a big, big platform that people aren't just mimicking or getting, you know, catching the fever of the moment.
Right. You know? That's true.
Because a lot of big pulpits do that, yeah.
You're right, because a lot of people in Christians do that too. I had a lady I work with. She was, she's marrying a Nigerian, and she was saying his mom was saying that when she was in Nigeria, she's seen a mermaid twice in her life. And I noticed that with the Nigerian people, they talk a lot about the mermaid. What is your take on it? Do you think that that's something that's real?
Yes. They're related to them. They have strong connection to the genealogy along with the people in South Africa, especially towards Cape Town. Yes. Kudo Mudro goes into this too. The mer people had a connection to the African people. At one time, when we came to the planet originally, we came in water, and then we migrated onto land. So a lot of these people have a genetic connection to the mer people who live. They're very real. They've had documentaries on them. They live under the water. They actually work cohesively with the dolphins. That's why Hiroshima in Japan is paying right now for what they've done to the dolphins, which are sentient beings who are very close to the mer people. They're paying karmically for all they've done to all the life, the marine life that they've destroyed. So that's part of why their country is going under right now. But the Nigerians, yes, the South Africans, I believe the Samoans, which are in the Pacific, who else? There's a couple others. They're highly connected to genetically. They have some sort of DNA resonance with those entities. That's probably why their souls go underneath the ground. Remember, we have interterrestrials, too. So we have mer people, and then we have interterrestrials. So these beings are mixed with those people there. And many Nigerians talk about it very openly. And some of the babies back in the days were born with the legs cinched together, like the legs together, which is the crease in between. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And that makes
they're very real. Mm-hmm.
That makes a lot of sense. And if you, like the Dogon tribe, then they speak of the Nomo, and the Nomo is like fish people.
Mm-hmm.
So that pretty much kind of, to me, kind of connects their relationship with the mer people.
Absolutely. And then you have, I don't know if I'm pronouncing his name right, I'll give it to you later, DeVoe. DeVoe is a contactee, a white contactee from Australia, and he speaks about going to another planet where he saw beautiful little brown girls with dreadlocks riding dolphins in the water.
Yeah.
Beautiful. When he says it, I got such beautiful chills. He said he saw that, and he thought it was the wildest thing. He saw these beautiful little brown. And when a white person says that, sometimes you're like, wow. When the truth comes out, there's nothing he can make up. You know what I mean? It was something he saw. And he talks about the brown people and how the women, they wanted to breed with him, so some beautiful brown women with almost like elf-like ears, but they were brown women. Was seducing him. DeVoe, is his name DeVoe? I'll give you the name. It's fascinating. He's a contactee, and he talks about places, but I thought that was the most beautiful sight that one can see. And then it made sense when I heard about all the mer people and the connection to the Africans. Because if we come from worlds like that, remember, if the dolphins came down to this planet, it means the people that were with those dolphins came from that planet, too.
Yes.
Everything came together. Yeah.
Right. And the speaking of the dolphins, they are like the highest intelligent mammals on Earth. So, what is their connection to us? Like, are they?
A lot of us come from their same star system. They're essential beings. I remember going to Virginia Beach. Matter of fact, this is freaky. I just remember that not too long ago. I can't believe I forgot about it. I had the same with Edgar Casey, and again in a past life. I remember being in his hospital there. It was weird. Some odd things. I remember being from the South as a little girl and being in the place. So I had this obsession from young of going to Edgar Casey's place. So I went to a spiritual retreat with a girlfriend for a weekend to Virginia Beach. I loved it. I went to his facility at Virginia Beach. It was really nice. It was cool. And I had the weirdest experience. I had no idea. I went there. And we were in the room that night. It was like, oh, it's so cool. We did meditation. We were doing all this kind of telekinesis, like talking to each other in our head. And then we were in the room, and all of a sudden, the wall started to permeate in different colors. So my girlfriend said, I wonder if she still has this tape. I got to find out. She taped everything. Cause that's the wonderful thing about having other conscious people, because they tape everything. They document everything. Because we know that people are going to think we're cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. We don't get documentation.
Right.
So I remember seeing the wall permeating. And, I mean, we're just in the room getting ready. We're in a hotel room. It's not a big deal.
Right.
Was this before bed? Oh, no, we just did a lecture for the whole day. And it was like 8 o'clock at night, but we were tired because we had to get up in the morning. The wall was permeating back and forth like it was breathing. She was bugged out. And we're not high. I have to tell people, I don't do drugs. I'm healthy.
Right.
You know, I actually parent. So, you know, I'm pretty sane. I remember seeing these silver-looking entities peeking out every time it breathed inward. It was the oddest thing. I was like, oh, shoot, do you see that? She was like, I see the wall moving out. She didn't see the entities. Then all of a sudden, the top of my crown and my head started to breathe. Now, this will freak you out. It started to breathe like open. I felt like something was opening at the top of my head and closing, like breathing.
Wow.
She's like, what the hell is that? She's
right.
So she's like, Mina's like, just go into it. Just go into it. Just feel it out. So I know to go into a meditative kind of sit quietly and allow myself to read. It's an energy that's talking to me.
Okay.
Now I'm feeling my head open and closed. Oh, and I couldn't understand. I was like, what is that? I could feel like I was somewhat wet, like I was cold but not cold. It was the oddest thing in the world. We did that for an hour. She documented everything. I could tell what I was feeling. I was crying because I felt something. Now, the next day we went to the facility, you know, because we had the last part of the weekend of the lecture, and we asked, you know, some of the people there, some of the lecturers there. I said, listen, I had this experience, blah, blah, blah. They were like, oh, my God. Are you serious? I was like, yeah. I was like, do people have this? They were like, no, but the dolphins just migrated in here yesterday. They just came in. And
wow.
You know how dolphins, the portals and whales and stuff, it opens on top of their head, like the holes
yes.
breathe out, they blow the water out, and it comes in?
Right.
That's what I was feeling. They were speaking to me. I had a connection to them. Who would have freaking known that?
Right,
The lecturer freaked out because I didn't know what it was. I'm not a dolphin. I'm not a whale. I don't know. I love animals, but I wouldn't equate my crown opening up and out like that of the hole in the dolphin and the whale when they're breathing in and out. Whatever
right.
it was that I experienced, those dolphins connected to me. And it could be, again, we're mixed with those people.
Yes.
It's a connection that they had with me. They just migrated the day before when I had it that night.
Wow.
And I felt to them coming in, I had no idea. And that's why I say we're very connected to them. How, I don't
yeah.
know. They're from the same star system. So I felt them. And they probably
uh-huh.
communicated, but I wasn't conscious. You know, I wasn't as conscious as I am now. I probably could have picked up something, you know, maybe telepathically, but I wasn't prepared for that at the time. No.
Right.
No, not at all.
Don't they communicate through bubbles or something?
They do. And the clicking that we do, all that clicking that some of the tribes do in Africa, comes from them being mixed those entities. Because under the water, it sounds like clicking. And they still have the same language that they speak with the dolphins.
Wow. That is amazing. That's amazing.
And it's, and what a lot of us should do if we have autistic sons or daughters, as melanated people of strong melanation, I would think it's very therapeutic if you take your children to places where there's dolphins for them to swim with, and I believe they would be healed almost instantaneously by having contact with their ancestors.
Wow, that is funny you say that because that was one of my things I wanted to do with my son is take him to Florida. I've been looking at some places to
yeah.
take him to swim with the dolphins because I know
right here.
Yeah, in Florida.
By me.
Yeah, I saw that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wow.
You know where I am. You know where I be.
Yes.
You come right here. You know what I'm saying? They have, what is it? Because my daughter was talking about it. They have, she keeps asking, we're going to go, she wanted to do it for her birthday, actually. It's part of SeaWorld. It's right up the road. Oh, darn, what is it called? Dolphin Cove. You swim with them. You interact with them, but money brown people. I'd be interested to see how brown people and the dolphins react.
Mm-hmm.
I'd be very interested to see that interaction. To be honest,
that would be excellent. And you said I'll get everything, all the info from you because I've been looking at a few spots.
Come on up, that'd be fun.
Oh, wow. This has been such a good conversation. And you know, we set this show for like 1 hour. It went 2 hours.
I know. I'm sorry.
No, not at all. Because whatever spirit wanted to get out, spirit definitely got out. And
it did.
We're so thankful to you, beautiful goddess. And
oh, thank you. I'm grateful for you.
Yes, we're sorry if we didn't get to our callers, but we had to get the information out there, and of course we're going to definitely have Fleurbrun on again. So
stay away from the light. Stay away from the light.
Yes. Yes. And definitely hold on to your questions for next time. And also download this call and spread the word and start awakening our people up and letting them know that, yes, more to life than love and hip hop. Okay? So.
That's right. Yes, indeed.
Get out of that matrix. And once you get out of that matrix, then you can watch Love and Hip Hop and there's no judgment. You won't.
That's true.
It won't matter. You know, you'll know what's going on. But get the message out to awaken our family and let them know that, hey, you know, you need to wake up. You need to get more conscious into what's going on and not be so much into the BS, because there's so much BS going on and a lot of people play into it. And it's been like a learning lesson for me, especially working in the workplace, and you see the BS and you're like, wow, like I could choose if I want to play that role and be in the BS, or I can just stand back and watch the BS go on. So remember, you have the choice. And
wow.
I just stand back and witness it and be like, wow, I'm glad I just chose not to be a part of it, because it will lower your vibration and it will keep you separated from what's truly necessary for you to evolve. So, you know, just stand back from it. Just look at it. Just observe. Be the observer and not so much the participant all the time.
Definitely
to see some sort of shift in your life, because it's an illusion. Definitely. And we cannot say this enough about the fear. Let it go. Really got to let this fear go. When you really think about the fact that there are beings feeding off of our fears, once, you know, me and Fluerbrun were talking about this, it really made me like, wow, like say to myself, like, wow, why let a being feed off of me in fears that don't even exist?
It's like
so
letting somebody live in your house for free who ain't paying rent.
Yeah.
Just watching cable and loving hip-hop all day and not paying any bills. It's like that.
Right. So this is the release. Let go of the fear, you know, and know that, yeah, you have power over this illusion. And that definitely assists me in knowing that there's nothing to be afraid of. So, and we just hope that you all got something out of this that you can pass on to your family, your loved ones, your friends, and let them know it's time to be fearless. We are powerful people, you know, and if we are dealing with things that we don't know how to deal with, you know, replay this broadcast and listen to some of the tips that she gave to break yourself out and become a sovereign being once again, because we are sovereign. It might not feel like it because we're so caught up into what it looks like. But once we break ourselves from what it looks like and know what it really is, then we can move on to that next level of evolution and be living a pretty free life here. Even though we know BS is going to always exist, we are able to look past it and still have a particular type of life that we want to create. So I just want to say, is there anything else you want to say, sis, before we go?
No, I just wish everybody well. And again, if anything I stated was offensive, I love all good people and all souls. And if I have a conversation about any particular ethnicity or background, I do realize that I've been everything in every lifetime, and it's all relative.
Mm-hmm.
So please know it's all coming from love-based and also giving information to a people that have been deprived for so long. But it's all love.
It's all love, and that's the whole thing. The key is unconditional love, because when love exists, fear cannot. So
Right. Everything
is that, you know, we talked about tonight was in love, and it's just to bring you into awareness and to comfort you to know that this is a game that you created. So be the best actress or actor that you can be. Be dramatic as you can be, but just know that you are the one creating this hologram. So, yes, baby doll. We are done. We look forward to having the goddess back within a few weeks, I guess. We gotta do some updates.
That's right. Thank you. Thank you, ladies. It's always a pleasure to be in the presence of other goddesses, and I appreciate your platform, and you're doing a lot for the stimulation of our consciousness, everyone. So I'm grateful.
Right, and we're grateful for having you and spreading your wisdom and knowledge, goddess, because it's very well needed in our community, and we just love the fact that it just brings awareness. There's a lot of people who are listening. I mean, me and my sister, we're like amazed, like at the downloads that we get for, you know, the show, like that you're on, like the last show that you and Barry were on. I mean, it got so many downloads. I'm like, wow, you know, this is what people want to know about, but they just like maybe in hiding about it. But it's okay. Come on out.
I'm out the closet. We got our arms open.
Absolutely. All right. So we just send peace and love to our listeners, and we just thank you for supporting us. And you can reach us at goddesssweet@gmail.com. And for media information, what's the link, Holistic Al?
goddesssweetmedia@gmail.com. And you can also check out our archive videos on YouTube at Goddess Sweet Media.
All right. As always, we love you all. Peace and light. I don't know if I should say light, sir, bro.
Don't say the light.
Peace and darkness.
Stay in the dark. Black, darkness. Darkness is your friend. Word.
All right, we love you all.
Peace, ladies. Have a wonderful night. Okay,
bye-bye. You too, love. All right, good night.